So I think I'm going to get started and let people trickle in. So thanks for showing up at 9. My topic's on steroids and selected presentations for their use in the emergency department. So before I start off, I need to thank a few people. Deb Eagles is my supervisor. Thank you so much for all of your input in my slides and the content and the last-minute emails. I also need to thank my mentors, Dr. Lepard and Clark, for their input and their tips. Drs. Nick Costain and George Mastoras for content and slide review, as well as Cheryl for some of the TOH-related data. I also need to thank some of the staff in internal medicine and in ICU for their emails and for their input based on some of the topics, mainly in regarding pneumonia. Okay, so over the next hour, we're going to explore the evidence and hopefully generate some good discussion surrounding several controversial uses of steroids in the emergency department. My hope is to review the updates for the latest evidence for or against steroids in the use of anaphylaxis, or namely biphasic anaphylaxis, as well as sepsis, and go over the recent literature that was published surrounding community-acquired pneumonia and sciatica. There's a lot of content that I need to get through, so if you wouldn't mind holding your questions till the end, I'll leave some time for questions and discussion. Thanks. All right, so case one is a 36-year-old male with urticaria. He's presenting with facial edema. He was at work. He was on a set of a cooking show when a coworker noticed some facial swelling. He has no history of anaphylaxis, but he does have a positive history of asthma and atopy. And he's stable when he comes in, but he's a little bit tachycardic. His history is basically...
No, I think you have food allergies.
The sound's not too relevant.
What?
Benadryl? Where's the Benadryl?
Aisle 2.
Which one's aisle 2?
The one with the big 2 over it.
Sarah, I'm fine.
You sure it's in aisle 2?
No.
Really, it is not that serious.
Benadryl. A lot of Benadryl. A lot of Benadryl.
What?
All right. So in September, the Canadian Institute for Health Information released a report that ED visits for anaphylaxis have doubled over the last 7 years in Canada. They attribute this to an increase in awareness and recognition of the signs and symptoms by the community, but also suggest an increase in prevalence of allergies. Complete data was only available for the provinces of Ontario and for Alberta, but in 2013, 1% of ED visits were for allergic reactions. 8% of those were for anaphylaxis. Now, you can see at our civic hospital in the last quarter, we had 99 visits for allergy, and about a quarter of those were for allergic reactions. So it's a little bit higher than the 8%, at least in the civic for our last quarter. So just out of curiosity, how many people here routinely give steroids, whether it's oral or IV solumedrol, when someone comes in with anaphylaxis to the emergency department? Show of hands. So a good two-thirds of people. Now, how many send them home with a course or a prescription for oral steroids? One, maybe two? Okay, so we'll go over some of the evidence for or against that. Just for a brief review, I know everybody likes immunology. Anaphylaxis is traditionally understood as a type 1 hypersensitivity reaction. It's commonly but not always mediated by an IgE reaction. Circulating antibodies from prior sensitization can mount a rapid systemic response, and this acutely causes mast cells and basophils to degranulate and release histamines, leukotrienes, cytokines, and other inflammatory molecules to mount an allergic reaction. The rationale for steroids is based on their anti-inflammatory effect and proven benefit in similar atopic conditions such as asthma, but not in anaphylaxis itself. The primary action of steroids is to downregulate the late eosinophilic inflammatory response as opposed to the early phase response. The current evidence for steroids consists mainly of retrospective studies, case reports, and descriptive literature, but we're starting to see some RCTs. Now, theoretically, we've learned that a biphasic reaction can occur, which is defined as a return of symptoms after complete resolution of initial symptoms without a subsequent exposure to an allergen. Now, this delayed response can occur up to 72 hours, but we know that it's usually within 8 hours. That's why we end up observing people in our department. The literature reports a range between 1 to 20% of incidents of biphasic anaphylaxis. It's really unclear who develops these secondary reactions, but the risk is higher in those with a more severe initial reaction, those with laryngeal edema involvement, those who are hypotensive, those who have had a delay or an inappropriate administration of epinephrine, or those with a previous history of a biphasic reaction. So the most recent review was a Cochrane review in 2012, where they sought to analyze the benefits and harms of steroid treatment during anaphylaxis. They had a sound search strategy, which included RCTs that compared steroids with any control, that's placebo, epi, antihistamines, or a combination thereof. And their primary outcome was to look at the mortality rate with various other secondary outcomes, including prevention of biphasic reactions within 72 hours. They looked through over 1,500 records, leading to 18 articles, but bottom line is they couldn't find any RCTs that satisfied the inclusion criteria. There are no RCTs out there for epi, and they couldn't find any RCTs out there for anaphylaxis. So they were unable to make any recommendations for or against the use of steroids in the treatment of anaphylaxis, so I found that pretty interesting. In 2014, practice parameters were published in the Annals of Allergy, Asthma, and Immunology. They were written by an American task force comprised of 13 physicians as a resource for emergency physicians and a collaborative between allergists and ED docs. I find it interesting to note that they write this, but there were no ED physicians included on that panel when you actually go through it. They state that there's no strong evidence that supports the use of steroids in the management of anaphylaxis. It's supposed to say no definitive evidence that steroids decrease the risk of biphasic reactions, although there's a theoretical possibility owing to their anti-inflammatory properties. So I know this text is really small. You're not meant to read all of it, but this is the management algorithm that they suggest. The first red box indicating that IM epinephrine is the main goal here, and then secondary interventions can be thought of, and these include an epi infusion, bronchodilators, steroids, antihistamines, glucagon. And then at the bottom, the last red box is consider prescriptions for oral antihistamines and steroids, even though they just said that there's really no evidence to support that. So I was interested in what we do at TOH. Now, this is our TOH anaphylaxis algorithm, which kind of groups everything together. We are to give epinephrine, Benadryl, ranitidine, and solumedrol. So it really doesn't give us that option, at least in this algorithm suggestions. In 2015, there was a paper in the Annals of Emergency Medicine. This was a retrospective cohort study with 2,700 people. And the objective was to determine the association of steroid administration with improved clinical outcomes. And this is namely by subsequent allergy-related ED visits within 7 days in the steroid and non-steroid exposed groups. They looked at secondary outcomes within 7 days, and this included all-cause mortality and the number of clinically important biphasic reactions, as well as the number of participants with repeated ED visits that weren't related to allergy. The study was performed in the emergency department of two Vancouver teaching hospitals, and they used their electronic medical record systems to identify presentations for allergic reaction, and this also included anaphylactic reaction. They defined anaphylaxis by the three usual definitions as outlined in the chart below. And the results were that 44% received steroids in their department, 17% received them IV, 29% oral, and 3% received both. 30% of people received prescriptions for prednisone, steroids. Actually, this was for prednisone, with a median dose of 50 milligrams and a median duration of 5 days. And 48% of patients received steroids overall. I do need to note that although the steroid and non-steroid groups were similar in most aspects, the steroid group had a higher proportion of patients who were transported by ambulance, who had mucosal tissue involvement, who had wheeze or stridor, and who were treated with epinephrine. So it might suggest that these patients were sicker. Their outcomes, the results showed that there were 6% of allergy-related revisits in total, with no significant differences between the steroid and non-steroid groups, no differences in those who had a discharge diagnosis of anaphylaxis. It was interesting to note that there was a number needed to treat of 176 to prevent one revisit to ED. Their secondary outcomes were that there were 5 clinically important biphasic reactions, 4 patients in the steroid group and 1 in the non-steroid group. So to think about is that the number of biphasic reactions were higher in the steroid group. So were these patients sicker to begin with? And were they more likely to have a biphasic reaction in the first place? Another question that I had was, might this number have been even higher if they didn't receive steroids? Other secondary outcomes were that there were no deaths reported, and for patients who received steroids in the department, there was no difference in revisits for those who received prescriptions for those who didn't. So overall, their conclusion was that steroid use is not superior to no steroids comparing ED revisits at 7 days. The strengths were that you would think that it's an applicable patient population to a Vancouver teaching hospitals to ours, as well as there is excellent follow-up over 99% because they use their EMR system. Some of the limitations being that it was a retrospective study with only 2 centers. There were different types of steroids given in the department, whether it was epi or prednisone, although their prescriptions afterwards were prednisone. And they were unable to confirm that patients filled and took their medications once they left the department. So the bottom line for steroids and anaphylaxis is that there's no strong evidence that steroids reduce biphasic anaphylaxis reactions. Patients that are allowed to leave the emergency department after complete resolution of symptoms do not routinely need further treatment with steroids. However, they're still listed in the guidelines and can be considered for some patients. So I think I would stop and at least think about it in patients who had some of the severe risk factors. So those who had late administration of epi, multiple administrations of epi, mucosal involvement, those who've had a history of biphasic anaphylactic reactions, I would think about the benefit versus the harms in those people. Okay, so moving on to case 2. You have a 6-year-old lady who presents with weakness. The history is really vague. She's been weak for a week, and she comes in with fever and confusion today. She looks really unwell. She's febrile, tachycardic, hypotensive, breathing pretty fast. So overall, the patient looks septic, but the source is unknown at this time. So we know that there have been large trials for sepsis in the past, and my objective is not to rehash these trials today. The INANE trial in 2002 showed there was a mortality benefit with stress-dose steroids and sepsis, but this was only after an adjustment analysis was performed on baseline characteristics. Now, the Corticus trial in 2008 did not show mortality benefit, but this was an underpowered study. So there's been a bit of controversy with regards to steroids and sepsis. What I did want to do is focus on the most recent Cochrane review in 2015, which was an update. It examined the effects of steroids on death at 1 month, so an all-cause mortality at 28 days, they describe, in patients with sepsis. And they examined whether dose and duration influenced patient response. This was a study that included 33 RCTs in over 4,200 hospitalized patients with a diagnosis of sepsis. I do need to mention that 3 trials included children. 28 trials were looking at steroid versus placebo, and 5 looked at steroids versus standard therapy. However, it should be noted that 10 trials were funded by a drug company, 13 trials were funded by public organizations or charities, and 10 stated no funding source. So the primary outcomes, as I mentioned, they were looking at 28-day all-cause mortalities. The secondary outcomes included ICU mortality, hospital mortality, shock reversal as defined by stable hemodynamic status at 24 hours after withdrawal of vasopressors, also measured at days 7 and 28. Organ dysfunction at day 7 as measured by the SOFA score, and the SOFA score determines the rate of organ failure based on 6 scores for respiratory, cardiovascular, hepatic, coagulation, renal, and neurological systems, and total scores can be predictive of mortality. They also looked at length of ICU stay and hospital stay and adverse events that occurred. The authors used a methodologically sound search strategy with inclusion of RCTs comparing steroids versus placebo or supportive treatments in sepsis. So this is a table that summarizes their outcomes, and I'll go over a summary of this table again, but it outlines their outcomes, the number of patients included in studies, and in parentheses is the number of studies included in that outcome. As well as the risk ratios and the quality of study as measured by the grade system. Now, the grade system outlines the extent to which we can be confident that the estimates of effect are correct. This is based on the type of study design, the risk of bias, the consistency of the results across studies, as well as the precision of the overall estimate across studies. For each outcome, the quality of the evidence is rated as high, moderate, low, or very low. And as you can see here, I'll summarize what they found. So they did find that there was reduced 28-day all-cause mortality, but this had a low grade score. So it was statistically significant. It was found to be a reduction by 13%, but the quality of the outcome was downgraded for imprecision and significant heterogeneity across trial results. This was related in part by dosing strategies and difference in study populations. There was a reduced 28-day mortality in the long course low dose steroids, and this was with moderate strength. They suggested that the steroids should be given at a lower dose, so to the equivalent of 400 milligrams of hydrocortisone on a daily basis for a longer duration, so for a minimum of 3 days at full dose, and the severity of illness also affected their rates. They found that mortality was reduced in both ICU and in-hospital deaths with moderate evidence. They found there was an increased shock reversal by day 7 and 28 with high evidence, decreased length of stay in ICU by 2 days, decreased length hospital stay, decreased length of stay in hospital by 4 days. But they did find an increase in rates of hyperglycemia, and this was pretty consistent. However, they found there was no increase in significant GI bleeding or superinfections, and this was all with high evidence. So overall, the authors concluded that steroids may favorably impact all-cause mortality at 28 days and reduce ICU and hospital length of stay. If given, it should be given at a lower dose, so the equivalent or less of 400 milligrams of hydrocortisone for a minimum of 3 days at full dose. They go on to state that this is preferably in patients with septic shock, sepsis, and ARDS, or community-acquired pneumonia and illness-related corticosteroid insufficiency, but they didn't specifically look at those in subgroup analyses. Okay, so the bottom line for steroids in sepsis, based on this update, is that there may be a benefit, but the data is not robust. I think there's a role for further research to clarify the use of steroids in different types of sepsis, the optimal timing for initiation of the treatment, the optimal dose, the choice, and duration of steroid, as well as there needs to be more data in a pediatric population. So what I did want to put on your radar is the adrenal study, which is currently enrolling patients and set to be published around 2017, is what they say. It will include 3,800 ICU patients who have septic shock, which will make it the largest trial for steroids in sepsis. They'll use 200 hydrocortisone, 200 milligrams versus placebo daily for a week as a continuous IV infusion while in ICU. The primary outcome will be mortality at 90 days, and similarly secondary outcomes will be measured as to the secondary outcomes I illustrated below. And this will be in multiple centers, so mainly in Australia and New Zealand, as well as some sites in Europe and Asia. So that's something to watch out, to look out for. So case three. You have a 6-year-old lady who's coming in with cough. She's had a productive cough with sputum production for about 7 days. She's had fever for 3 days. She doesn't have a history of COPD or lung disease. She's tachycardic, but her sats are low. She looks unwell, and she looks like she probably needs to come into hospital. And on X-ray, you do see a consolidation consistent with a pneumonia. A little bit of pneumonia trivia. How many patients do you think that we saw in the civic emergency in our last quarter? So that's from October to December 2015. By a show of hands, who thinks that we saw 50 to 100 patients? 100 to 150? Two hands? 150 to 200? Maybe half the people? And over 200? One hand. And some people who aren't sure. Okay, so we saw 228 patients in our emergency department in the last quarter, 95 of whom were admitted to hospital with an admission diagnosis of pneumonia, query pneumonia, pneumosepsis, or something of that sort. So pneumonia, community-acquired pneumonia, is common and a potentially serious illness. Up-to-date reports mortality rates from a 1996 JAMA meta-analysis that included 127 studies and reported outcomes in over 33,000 patients. And they said that mortality ranges from 5% in ambulatory and hospitalized patients. They did this because ambulatory patients weren't looked at on their own. 13% in hospitalized patients, and 36% in ICU patients. Obviously, these rates are affected by patient comorbidities. And as we know, hospitalizations are frequent, and they're costly both in an administrative level and to a patient mortality morbidity level. In 2010, a Cochrane review was published that looked at the treatment of pneumonia with steroids. I won't review it in complete detail, but at that time, only six RCTs met inclusion criteria, and only two were of high quality. Overall, they found that steroids were generally beneficial for accelerating time to resolution of symptoms, but the evidence was not strong enough to make any concrete recommendations. Since 2010, there have been an additional seven RCTs, two of which were published last year in Lancet and JAMA, one that we reviewed in a journal club. So I'm going to talk about these three papers, focusing on the last one, which is a systematic review and meta-analysis, which includes the two prior ones. Okay. So the Lancet paper was published by Bloom et al. It was a multi-center double-blind placebo-controlled RCT that includes 785 patients, so this was the largest RCT. They enrolled consecutive patients in seven tertiary care centers in Switzerland. And their objective time was primary objective was time to clinical stability, measured by a number of days until stable vital signs for 24 hours. Their primary outcome was earlier time to clinical stability, and their intervention was prednisone 50 milligrams daily versus placebo for 7 days. They did both intention to treat and per protocol analyses. So the results are as follows. So on the graph, the y-axis is showing probability of instability. The x-axis is showing time. The prednisone group is shown in blue, and the placebo group is in red. There was a decreased time to clinical stability by 1.4 days when comparing groups, and this was favoring the steroid group. That was their primary endpoint. When you look at secondary endpoints, you see a decrease in time to hospital discharge, also by about a day. And as a result, you also see a decrease in days of IV antibiotics, and those were the only two significant secondary outcomes. So overall, their conclusion was that prednisone treatment for 7 days in admitted patients with community-acquired pneumonia decreases time to clinical stability. So the strengths are that it was the largest study to date with both strong methodology and both intention to treat and per protocol analyses. The limitations, as we discussed in Journal Club, was the applicability of their patient population. So all the studies were done in Switzerland. But I think the important part was the primary endpoint being a composite of physiological measurements which can be affected by steroids. So this was not a clinical event such as mortality. So in Journal Club, we thought that the relevance of their findings may have been of questionable clinical significance. Now, this is a JAMA study that was done a month later by Torres et al. I'll briefly outline it, but I won't dissect it in much detail. So it's a multicenter double-blind placebo-controlled RCT that had 120 patients. It was appropriately powered. This was done in 3 teaching hospitals in Spain, and the objective was to assess steroids in severe community-acquired pneumonia and high-associated inflammatory response. Now, they measured inflammatory response with a CRP at admission, and I don't think most of us are doing this. There were 61 patients in the steroid group and 59 in the placebo group, and their treatment was an IV bolus of methylprednisolone, 0.5 milligrams per kilogram, twice a day for 5 days. And again, they did intention to treat and per protocol analyses. Their primary outcomes were early treatment failure and late treatment failure, defined by the following criteria. So the results were, overall, the authors report a strong benefit and a reduction of treatment failure by 31% in the steroid group versus 13% in the placebo group. However, this is all driven by late treatment failure of disease, driven by progression on chest X-ray. So really no benefit is seen early within 72 hours, and these are not mortality results. I don't think you can extrapolate the progression of pneumonia on chest X-ray, and really I don't know that clinically we do the same. So overall, their conclusions were that in patients with severe community-acquired pneumonia, steroids decrease late treatment failure as measured by radiographic progression on chest X-ray. The strengths were that there was a high completion rate and that it was an adequately powered study. The limitations I found outweighed some of their strengths, that the baseline characteristics, they were for the most part similar, but the placebo group had patients that looked sicker, so more of them were on ventilators, more of them were in shock. The data collection took place over 8 years to get 120 patients. So I would argue that a lot has changed in management of pneumonia over the span of 8 years, as well as the bugs. It applies to be a large trial, but it only applies to patients with severe pneumonia. And then, as I mentioned, the questionable usefulness of progression of disease on chest X-ray as a measure of an outcome. So now, this trial was published in the Annals of Internal Medicine. It's probably the most important. So this was a systematic review and meta-analysis of all of the RCTs through to May 24th, 2015. And it includes the two trials that I talked about, that I just talked about. Investigators were mostly in Europe, but they did have a Gordon guide on there. The objectives were to examine the effect of steroids on mortality, morbidity, and duration of hospitalization, and the study received no external funding. So the methodology included an adequate search study by 2 reviewers to independently screen and determine eligibility of studies, and a third reviewer to resolve any disagreement by discussion. So the eligible studies reported reported in any language, had patients that were assigned to oral or IV corticosteroids versus placebo or no treatment. They reported on at least one of the following measures. And they use, again, they use the grade system to analyze the certainty of the evidence. So I've summarized the different RCTs that were included in the trial. You can see when they were published. The two that I discussed are bolded there. There are variable locations. And again, the Bloom study had the largest number of patients. They used variable doses, types of steroids for different durations. So there's lots of variability there in the medication administered. Above, you see the forest plot for the effect of steroids on reduction of all-cause mortality. They are separated by severe pneumonia and less severe pneumonia. And there were 12 trials included. There was an absolute risk reduction of 2.8%. To put this in perspective, I calculated this to have a number needed to treat of 36. So given grade scores, this had moderate certainty. And this was driven by small studies, which had some methodological limitations. And the data's not robust, given the heterogeneity of the studies themselves and their enrollment sizes. You see here the need for ventilation, which had 5 trials with 1,060 patients, an absolute risk reduction of 5%, and a number needed to treat of 20. With regards to development of ARDS, there were only 4 trials with 945 patients, an absolute risk reduction of 6%, a number needed to treat of 16 with a moderate certainty. And in duration of hospitalizations, there were 3 studies judged to be at low risk of bias, which included over 1,200 patients. They showed a significant reduction in the length of hospitalization with a mean difference of 1 day, and this was with high certainty. Here, this is actually the absolute risk increase of hyperglycemia, and that was found to be 3.5%, with a number needed to harm of 29 and high certainty. So the overall conclusions of this paper was that systemic corticosteroids may lead to reduced mortality by 3%, with a number needed to treat of 36. Reduced need for mechanical ventilation by 5% with a number needed to treat of 20, reduced ARDS by 6% with a number needed to treat of 16, reduced hospital stay by 1 day and reduced time to clinical stability, and increased hyperglycemia with a number needed to harm of 29, but no increase in GI bleeds. So the strengths of the study were that they reported clinically relevant outcomes, and there was sound methodology. They had good follow-up. However, the limitations were the different doses, routes of steroids, as I showed in the chart, few events and trials for many outcomes, as well as heterogeneity of data for their primary outcome, which was the mortality at 28 days. So I was wondering, what are we doing at the Ottawa Hospital? I was curious as to what our internal medicine colleagues are doing and what our ICU colleagues are doing, because these studies were all done in inpatients. So I asked Dr. Karavich, who's the chief of medicine, and he said that I could quote him. He said, this is ready for prime time. So he is on board with this from an administrative standpoint. If it reduces time to clinical stability, if it reduces length of stay, this is better for patients. You save costs in the hospital. But overall, when I ask other medicine staff, so I asked 4 internal medicine staff, there's no consensus yet. It's mixed opinion. They did have a journal club on this. And their main concerns were, are there population differences? Can we apply these studies to our population? There are no great guidelines with regards to the type of steroid, when they should be initiated, and for how long. But overall, about half of the staff seem to be using steroids in their older patients if they have underlying respiratory disease or if they seem sicker when they're admitted with pneumonia. Now, in the ICU, I also asked for critical care docs, and there was no consensus. However, There were fewer objections. They seemed more likely to give steroids because they said that many patients in the ICU are already on steroids anyway for other reasons. So overall, the bottom line for steroids in community-acquired pneumonia is that in sick patients admitted with pneumonia, steroids are worth considering. There may be a potential mortality benefit, reduced progression to ARDS and need for ventilation, but what we do see is we consistently see earlier times to stability and potential discharge from hospitals across various studies. Although, you know, as we know, there are lots of there are other factors when we consider a patient discharge, their social status, their comorbidities, so those also impact discharge from hospital. So it's pretty likely at this point that you are tired of listening to me talk. So I put in a 30-second break, stand up, do whatever you want, dance.
Con los terroristas.
30 seconds, I'm out. Okay, on case four, last and final stretch. You have a 50-year-old male who comes in with leg pain. He's had 2 weeks of excruciating left leg pain in his buttocks, and it radiates down to his ankle. He has pain on ambulation with improvement with standing. His vitals are stable. His physical exam is positive for a straight leg raise. He has normal, he's neurovascularly intact, but he does have an antalgic gait. So you think this guy has sciatica. So out of curiosity, how many people have seen or treated a patient with sciatica in the last 3 months? So a good 90% of people. Who's ever considered prescribing steroids to a patient with sciatica? One hand. And who has actually prescribed steroids? Have you, Dr. Niesbaum? No, okay, so nobody has. Okay, so in our last quarter, at the Civic Emergency Department, 59 patients were diagnosed with a discharge diagnosis of sciatica. Now, lower back pain, as we know, is a major health issue. It's kind of a pain, literally a pain in the butt. It's common, it's debilitating, it's really difficult to treat. Now, one method of treatment is an epidural steroid injection. However, these are problematic for a variety of reasons. They're invasive, they're costly, they require a pain specialist, they expose the patient to fluoro, and we don't commonly do that. So I'm not going to be discussing epidural steroid injections today, although most of the literature on sciatica is in epidural steroid injections rather than oral or IV steroids. NSAIDs or Tylenol, as well as activity modifications, are the mainstay of treatment with grade 2 C evidence. However, in 2007, the practice guidelines from the American Pain Society and the American College of Physicians stated that systemic steroids are ineffective for low back pain with radicular symptoms. So it was not recommended. The data on the efficacy of oral steroids is mostly negative. A systematic review and meta-analysis in 2011 in the Journal of Rheumatology showed that there have been 7 small trials that did not show much overall benefit and noted more side effects. It should be noted that efficacy was mainly determined by improvement of pain on a visual analog scale. And there were 3 studies out of these 7 that did rate disability. However, they were not all the same disability scoring tools. 2 of them used the same tool. So I wanted to go over this JAMA paper that was published in May of last year. This was a randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled study comparing 15 days of steroids versus placebo for acute sciatica. This was performed in 3 centers in California. It does not say that they were emergency departments. and the primary outcome was self-reported disability score on the ODI scale at 3 weeks, and I'll explain what that is. There were multiple secondary outcomes such as function at 6 months and a year, as well as pain. So the inclusion criteria were that the patients needed to have an MRI-proven herniated disc. This was confirmed by radiology or a neurosurgeon, as well as radicular pain radiating below the knee and a pain of moderate severity. So that's an ODI score of greater than 30%. Their exclusion criteria was that they had chronic pain lasting greater than 3 months, prior back surgery, diabetes, or a contraindication of administration of steroids. The intervention was oral prednisone, 15 days total, tapering from 60 to 40 to 20 milligrams, 5 days each. I do need to mention that they did not allow any NSAIDs for the first 3 weeks after randomizations to look at their primary outcome. Now, the ODI is the Oswestry Disability Index, and they use this to assess their primary outcomes. It asks, it's a survey for patients that asks functional questions and scores each section out of 5 for a total of 50 points. Now, disability is then reflected as a percentage, and in this study, you needed a score of 30 or greater. So scores less than 20 are minimally disabled, 20 to 40 are moderately disabled, more than 40 is severe, 60 to 80 is listed as crippled. On MRAP, they described that a score greater than 80 was indicative of malingering, which I thought was kind of funny. The primary results so this is a graph comparing the mean ODI score on the y-axis to time in weeks. So at 3 weeks, the scores improved from a mean of 51 to 32 in the steroid group and to 38 in the placebo group. So this is a statistically significant difference of 6 points on the ODI. The clinical meaning of this is unclear. The authors say that the clinical relevance is around a difference of 5 to 10. At 1 year, the ODI had dropped to 13 in the steroid group and to 20 in the placebo group. Now, this is a graph showing pain score versus time in weeks. This is one of their secondary outcomes. There was no significant difference in pain at any time. It should be noted also that there were more side effects in the steroid group than in the placebo group. These were described as mild and mostly anxiety and insomnia type symptoms, but there were no deaths or bleeding from the steroids. And this may have led to some unblinding biases. Patients may have figured out that they were on prednisone instead of placebo. So overall, the study shows that a 2-week course of steroids results in a mild improvement of sciatica symptoms in a highly selected patient group. This is really for patients with acute proven sciatica and not generic low back pain. The strengths included excellent follow-up at 3 weeks with only one patient per group lost to follow-up. And follow-up at 1 year was also good with a loss of only 3%, and the methodology was strong. However, the limitation was the effect size. In addition, they looked at the effect of steroids. This was without the use of NSAIDs, which I think is uncommon in our practice, but really goes to measure the effect of the steroids. It's for acute proven sciatica, and that there may have been some unblinding of patients due to the side effects of the steroids. So my bottom line for steroids and sciatica is that in selected patients, it may be reasonable to give a short burst of oral steroids. However, we should know that the natural history of back pain is not a full resolution in 3 to 4 weeks. And if you look at the study and the graph that I showed, many still have moderate disability and presence of pain at 1 to 2 years. So we should not be telling patients that their pain will be resolved within weeks. So the bottom line for all of the different topics I discussed today, so the first one, biphasic anaphylaxis, is that the evidence shows no difference in preventing biphasic reactions. It's still on treatment guidelines, however, and can be considered for use in patients preventing with higher risk features or more severe reactions. Now, for sepsis, I don't think the evidence is robust enough to support its use in the emergency department. Steroids may favorably impact all-cause mortality at 28 days and reduce ICU and hospital length of stay. If given, it should be given at a lower dose for a longer duration, but I still think that the evidence is not robust, and this may be more of an ICU decision, and we should keep our eyes out for what the adrenal study shows in 2017. Now, for community-acquired pneumonia and patients being admitted for community-acquired pneumonia, community-acquired pneumonia in general, I think the evidence is pretty strong that it shortens time to clinical stability and length of stay, albeit, as I discussed, many people have social dispositions that affect that. There is weak evidence that there suggests a mortality benefit in sicker patients. Therefore, in patients being admitted with community-acquired pneumonia who look sicker, if I thought the benefit would outweigh the harm, I would give a dose. In patients I discharge home, I would not, as there's no evidence for this yet. And finally, in sciatica, I'm not yet convinced, however, I would at least consider it in acute presentations for patients who wouldn't be adversely affected by a short course of outpatient steroids. I think there's potential benefit to little harm, but I think that the studies that have been done have been focusing on the wrong thing. They've been focusing on pain, and that future studies need to actually focus on disability and resolution of function, return back to work and daily activities. So I'd like to thank you for your attention and open this up for any questions or discussions at this time.